The next item of business is the selection of the Parliament's nominee as First Minister. A note explaining the procedures to be followed this afternoon has been made available to members. I have received 4 valid nominations for the selection of the Parliament's nominee for First Minister, and I will now announce the nominations in alphabetical order. The nominations are Alex Cole-Hamilton, Douglas Ross, Anna Sarwar and John Swinney. And I will ask each nominee to speak in support of their candidacy for up to 5 minutes, and there should be no interventions or interruptions. After the nominees have spoken, members will be asked to cast their vote for their preferred candidate. A separate vote will be called for each candidate, and members can vote only once. And once all voting has been completed, any member who has not yet voted will be invited to cast a vote to abstain, and there will be a short suspension while the result is verified, and I will then announce the results of voting. A candidate will be elected if an overall majority is obtained. If no majority is obtained, the candidate or candidates with the smallest number of votes will be eliminated. And I would ask members to note that if we have a vote between only 2 candidates, all that's required is a simple majority for one of the candidates to be elected. Members may wish to record an abstention, and no account of those votes will be taken in establishing whether a simple majority has been achieved, and will then proceed to a further round of voting. I call on Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer, and I offer my candidacy for the Office of First Minister of Scotland. I do so because while the governing party may have elected to forego any democratic process to test the ideas or motivations of their candidate, I don't think that Parliament should. Now, I do so more in hope than in expectation, but that hope among Liberal Democrats is growing, a hope self-evident in last week's English local election results, which saw us overhaul the Conservative Party for the first time in a generation. In Scottish opinion polls, which consistently show us growing significantly in this place, set to return many more MSPs, and in council elections results the length and breadth of Scotland, this Liberal revival is well and truly underway. Presiding Officer, as the outgoing First Minister has just said, this week we commemorate a quarter century of our reconvened Scottish Parliament. In the weeks following his installation as Deputy First Minister in 1999, my predecessor, the then leader of the Scottish Liberal Democrats, Jim Wallace, said, "Government involves hard choices and broad responsibilities. And there are inevitably times when the comfort zone of easy opposition beckons." Presiding Officer, I have spent enough time in opposition watching government ministers make poor decisions that make the lives of our constituents poorer still. And so I stand today. And those were simpler times. You could see your GP at the first time of asking, and your dentist still offered NHS care. Scottish education was amongst the best in the world, and all the ferries worked. It was so much easier to rent somewhere to live or to buy your first home. Our economy was growing and business thrived. But for nearly 20 years, the SNP have been ignoring the people who do most of the heavy lifting in our society. You're working harder, but it feels like you're falling further behind, like you're being taken for granted. Presiding Officer, we need ministers that won't make empty promises, but will get the basics right. We need new hope in our politics, and hope is at the heart of everything the Scottish Liberal Democrats stand for. We want to create world-class mental health services by taxing the social media giants who cause so much of the problem. That'll help get you faster access to your GP, and we'll make sure you can see an NHS dentist too. We will lift up Scottish education again by tackling the violence in our schools with more teachers and more in-class support. We'll reduce your bills and tackle climate change by rolling out a national insulation programme, and we'll get the government-owned water company to clean up its act and stop filling our rivers and our beaches with sewage. We want to offer a fair deal for our communities as well by actually giving power away from politicians back to local people, to answer the housing emergency by building more homes, encouraging confidence in investors and answering the needs of tenants and homeowners alike, to connect our communities with trains, buses and ferries that you can depend on. Presiding Officer, When this Parliament was reconvened, some of the challenges we now face must have seemed then almost inconceivable. The climate emergency, war in continental Europe, long COVID, cyber attacks on our health service, and the insidious reach of abused technology. Those challenges now require a response rooted not in the divisions of the past 17 years, but rather in cooperation here and beyond our borders. It's why Liberal Democrats want to put Scotland at the heart of a reformed Britain and to fix our broken relationship with Europe. Presiding Officer, the outcome of this election is already decided. I understand that. But if our new democracy, or our relatively new democracy, is about anything, it is about the exchange of ideas and of competing visions of what our country can become. So I humbly submit my candidacy today, and with it, a Liberal vision for the future of Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call on Douglas Ross.
It seems pretty likely that the leader of the largest minority party in Parliament, with the help of the fourth largest minority party, will be successful in this afternoon's election. Not my words, but actually the words of John Swinney when he was last SNP leader and seeking this Parliament's support to elect him as First Minister. That was 21 years ago, in May 2003. They say a week is a long time in politics, and I think the last 7 days have shown us that. But it is interesting to see John Swinney back seeking the support of this Parliament more than two decades on from his previous attempt. But today, Presiding Officer, I'm putting my name forward once more for the position of First Minister, because it is past time that Scotland has a leader focused on the issues that really matter to our nation, not another nationalist leader focused on the narrow political interests of the SNP. When this Parliament was elected almost exactly 3 years ago, Scotland was still in the midst of the COVID pandemic. And at that time, we all promised, each and every one of us, that we would put normal politics aside and focus on the national interest. Yet before all of the votes were even counted, the SNP had reverted to type, claiming that the election was a mandate for independence. And that has set the tone for this session. Gone was the golden opportunity to deliver transformative change for the people that we are so privileged to serve. Instead, we've now seen three SNP leaders saying that independence was and is their priority, and using this chamber and the Scottish Government as vehicles to campaign for it. It's abundantly clear that Scotland needs fresh leadership focused on the national interest. But the SNP have responded to calls for change by replacing one continuity candidate with another, by going backwards instead of forwards. This shows that the SNP can't change, that they will be the same distracted nationalist government run by the same people that we've seen for the last 17 years. After a decade of division, we need to get back to the priorities of the Scottish people. And that is the platform on which I and the Scottish Conservatives are proud to stand on. We're standing today to represent the people's priorities against an SNP government that only ever puts independence first. We believe Scotland can succeed now. The SNP think it can only succeed in some fantasy future. We think that the focus should be on the country's big challenges, not the SNP's obsession with independence. We want to improve our schools, not the SNP's plan to spend more money on promoting separation. We believe that our NHS should be focused on clearing patient treatment backlogs, not pushing the SNP's dangerous gender ideology on kids. We want free speech, not the SNP's hate crime act. We want to upgrade key roads and fix potholes, not penalise drivers with the SNP's workplace parking tax. We want to support 100,000 workers in Scotland's oil and gas industry, while the SNP wants to shut that sector down. We're standing up for rural Scotland, while the SNP continue to pursue a centralisation agenda. We would protect local services and our councils, while the SNP are stripping them of the powers and the funding they need. We want to make Scotland competitive within the UK, not punish families and businesses with SNP taxes. We want the country to unite for a stronger Scotland, not John Swinney's slogan, to unite for independence. Now, Presiding Officer, I'm not expecting to be elected as First Minister today. We already know that the SNP have done a backroom deal with the Greens to ensure that they abstain on the vote so that John Swinney will win. But beyond this chamber, the Scottish people are watching. Later this year, we will have a general election. And in that election, Scottish Conservative candidates will be standing across the country to beat the SNP and end their obsession with independence once and for all. We can see off John Swinney, just like we saw off Hamza Yousaf, and get the focus onto the issues that really matter. If voters unite behind the Scottish Conservatives in key seats right across Scotland, that is the opportunity for us all. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on Anna Sarwar.
Presiding Officer, Scotland needs stable and competent government. At a time when we face the twin challenges of the cost of living crisis, with families struggling to make ends meet, and an NHS crisis where too many Scots are struggling to access life-saving NHS treatment, we need a government that rises to those challenges, the biggest since devolution. Instead, we have an SNP government that is proving to be incompetent, divided and chaotic. The change of SNP leader and First Minister has actually nothing to do with delivering for Scotland. This is all about managing internal divisions within the SNP and nothing to do with actually running our country. Now, Presiding Officer, it's been a little over a year since we last met to elect a First Minister. And while the headlines will focus on the political personalities, it is worth reminding ourselves that incompetence has consequences, and the very same failures we raised last year are worse today. So we need more than just platitudes or promises of a different way of working or a re-emphasis of this government pretending its priorities are those of the people. We heard the exact same last year, and Scots are experiencing even worse outcomes now than they were then. Last year, we demanded action on the NHS crisis to bring down waiting lists. They're now longer, not shorter. Now over 820,000 Scots stuck on an NHS waiting list. Last year, we demanded action to tackle the record levels of homelessness. Today, it's worse, with almost 10,000 children living in temporary accommodation with no home to call their own. Last year, we demanded action to tackle the appalling levels of drug deaths, but suspected drug deaths have shamefully increased by 10% in that time. Last year, we demanded action on closing the attainment gap in our education system. Today, we see increased violence in our schools and continued decline on international league tables of our once great education system. So for all John Swinney and the SNP want to pretend that this is day one of a new government, the hard fact is that after 17 years of this SNP government, there is not a single institution that is stronger. Every single one is weaker on their watch. Now, Presiding Officer, I have no illusions about the outcome of today's vote. Terrified of the electorate, the SNP will once again put their party's interest before the national interest. But I don't believe, and more importantly, the public don't believe, that continuity will cut it, or that this chaos and incompetence is as good as it gets. But let me quote John Swinney in 2001. "We meet this afternoon to elect a new First Minister for the third time in this Parliament. The third occasion is the result of a farce inflicted on Scotland and its Parliament by, on this occasion, the SNP, and by absolutely nobody else. The party that now, without any democratic process, seeks to foist its unelected leader upon our country, the party that promotes its own by making cronyism a way of life, always lets Scotland down. This afternoon, the farce may be carried to its illogical conclusion." Given that's what John Swinney's view was then, why does he now fear the judgment of the Scottish people today? Because, Presiding Officer, now more than ever, our country needs credible and effective leadership. People need a government on their side, focused on creating jobs and lowering bills. They need a government that will renew and repair our NHS, putting patients and staff first. A government focused on building new homes and ending the housing emergency. A government that will raise education standards and bring opportunities to every community. A government that believes in economic growth and that is willing to unlock the potential of every Scot to deliver it. A government of integrity that will restore trust and hope in our politics and that rejects the politics of division and despair. And Scotland needs a First Minister who is focused on the future, not defending a record of failure or focused on the past. Scotland needs a First Minister who knows that they are here in the service of the whole country, not just their political party. And Scotland needs a First Minister who genuinely wants to bring this country together to build a better nation, not pit Scot against Scot. I believe change is possible. I believe Scotland's best days do lie ahead of us. So when the people do finally get their say, I am determined to win their trust, win their support and deliver the change Scotland needs.
Thank you. And I call on John Swinney.
Presiding Officer, I am greatly honoured to be a nominee for First Minister of Scotland. This year is a year of anniversaries for our new democracy. It is 25 years, as colleagues have said, since the establishment of this Parliament, and it's 10 years since the referendum on Scottish independence. So it is a time to reflect, but more importantly, to look to the future. Both those democratic events were a result of growing demand from many people in Scotland for self-government. The extent of that self-government journey is still a matter of debate, but we are all sitting here today because a sizeable majority believe that in key aspects of Scottish life it is better for decisions about Scotland to be made here in Scotland. The Labour Party and the Liberal Democrats should take pride in governing Scotland through the difficult early years of devolution, when much of the debate was about the cost of this building rather than about what we could do with the powers invested in it. The Conservatives, under the leadership of Annabel, now Baroness Goldie, can look back with great credit on the constructive way they often approached opposition, and they certainly helped me with a budget or two. The Scottish Greens have brought a distinctive voice to our politics and became the first Greens to serve in government in the United Kingdom. My party, the SNP, has used the powers of this Parliament to abolish tuition fees and prescription charges. We have brought in a more progressive income tax system, and through the Scottish Child Payment, we are lifting children out of poverty. Indeed, the Scottish Child Payment has been hailed as the most significant measure to tackle child poverty anywhere in Europe in 40 years. And in our National Health Service, despite its challenges, we have the best performing core A&E departments in the United Kingdom. Policy and record, of course, is a matter of debate and contest. But there is something I hope we can all agree on. I'm proud that it was an SNP government that was led by the first woman First Minister and then by the first Muslim First Minister. I want to pay tribute to Hamza Yousaf, a man of unfailing courtesy who served my party but also this Parliament and his country with distinction. When Hamza Yousaf announced his resignation, he said this: to my colleagues in the opposition, regardless of political party, I genuinely only wish you well. I bear no ill will and certainly bear no grudges against anyone. That is the dignified mark of a man I'm proud to call a colleague and friend. Throughout all of these 25 years of this Parliament, I've been privileged to serve my constituents and the people of Scotland. Indeed, I was a little perturbed to see listed in the entry in the Parliament website this morning under the heading Previous Roles the following statement: John has had 22 previous roles. The old joke about giving a busy man more to do seems relevant at this moment. Under the heading Parliamentary and Government Roles, as of this morning, it says, John does not have any parliamentary or government roles. It's that entry which I would like to change after this afternoon's vote. I hope we can all recognise that despite our political differences, we are all here because we want the best for Scotland, whatever our specific role happens to be. For me, it is with all my experience, but with much more than that, with my burning ambition for a better future for this country, that I am seeking to become First Minister. The idea of ambition brings me to the second of this year's anniversaries, the independence referendum of 2014. Both those who are against independence and those who are in favour deserve to be heard. Through dialogue, debate and deliberation, I believe it's possible to argue respectfully our different positions. For my part, I look at the years since 2014 and I see the impact of Brexit, the policy of UK austerity, the economic damage of the mini-budget, the fact that wages in the UK have stagnated, productivity is too low and inequality is far too high. I look at those independent countries that are comparable to Scotland, that are wealthier and more equal than the UK, and it reinforces my core belief that Scottish self-government is the right way forward for Scotland. Those of us who believe in independence do so because we believe it will equip this Parliament with the powers it needs to match the success of those comparable independent states. That, in turn, will mean more resources for our National Health Service and our public services, the opportunity to grow our economy free from a broken Westminster economic model, and the prospect of rejoining the European Union and escaping the damage of Brexit. I recognise that in all of this, it is essential for a First Minister to listen to other people's perspectives. That is, will be, of course, what I do. That includes listening to the people who voted for a pro-independence Parliament in 2021, listening also to those who take a different view, and then engaging in the lifeblood of our democracy, persuasion based on evidence whilst respecting honest and honourable differences. In that spirit, Presiding Officer, building on the achievements in government, a focus on the economy, our National Health Service and the public services, a drive to lift children out of poverty, and through patient dialogue, that I ask for the support of Parliament in becoming Scotland's next First Minister.
Thank you. Before we move on to the vote, there will be a short suspension. Can I ask all members who voted earlier to please refresh their voting app? Thank you.